All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Darren, and today I'll be talking about prototyping motion throughout the design process. Very quick intro about me. Currently, I'm working on design systems at Product Board as a design systems designer and a little bit on the front end. Before that, I was a product designer and design systems designer at Webflow. Before that, I co-founded a small design systems and prototyping agency with my wife called Space Farm. And before that, I was a digital designer at Saatchi & Saatchi Sofia. So I want to start with a very clickbait kind of open-ended question. What is prototyping? When you hear the word, what is your first association? Like, what do you feel like prototyping means in the design process? And I have one kind of a small problem with the whole term prototyping. I think it's very limited these days to something very high fidelity, something at the end of the process, something that's very polished, and something that's maybe not going to make it to the final product, but it's going to make it on Dribbble. So I think there's this pessimism towards prototyping that it's a throwaway artifact. And there are three main points I want to make today that are kind of related, but also different. The first one for me is that prototyping is a mental model, not a design artifact or a design tool that's called prototyping. I think prototyping is just a way of thinking. It's part of the whole design process. I think we can do prototyping from the very early stages of design up until the final engineering implementation, and it's just a way to consider your work. It's not definitely a high-fidelity framer prototype or a Pixate prototype or whatever you call prototyping tools. I don't think there's a strong distinction between design tools and prototyping tools. And the third point is that motion, I think, can make it to the final product with a little bit of care. It doesn't have to be thrown away. We don't have to keep it just for Dribbble. I think with the right intention, it can work in the actual app. So I'm going to start with early stage prototyping, and specifically with text-based prototyping. So it's not something that's super popular or even called this way all the time, but here's an example. Let's say I'm prototyping annotations UI for adding annotations to some app, whatever it is, just being able to click on stuff and add notes. So how I might prototype this in the very, very early stage is just using Markdown. So anything that's normal text, like clicks the annotation mode button, hovers anywhere on the canvas, is a user action. And anything that's in italics is what the system does, how the system responds. So let's say I'm in the first day of my project, and I just want to pour my head out. And I just want to get my initial thinking and share it with my teammates. I don't have to do any kind of visual prototyping. I can just go like a new annotation popover renders with a semi-quick whimsical animation from the bottom up and scaling. And that's actually describing the current level of fidelity I have in my head, so I can build up on top of it. And what are the upsides and the downsides for this approach? I think it's a great approach for collecting feedback very early on with very low investment. You can do it even the first day or even the first few hours of your project. You can quickly explore multiple flows. You can propose an idea to management or to someone higher up with very low investment in the first few days. And also, you can actually prototype an entire complex flow of a big feature with just text and then jump on top of it. It doesn't have to be limited to something small. I've created like 15 to 20 page docs with just text-based prototypes of interactions, and I think it works nice. You can post it on Notion or Dropbox Paper, collect feedback, and think it works. What it's not so good for, of course, exploring mid or high fidelity, testing with users, because no user is going to put themselves in the shoes of a user if they just see a piece of text. This doesn't make sense to them. Figuring out usability, ergonomics, and accessibility, that's not the right format for that. And the TLDR is, it's low investment for a reason. It's not going to be low investment and be magic. It's the most bare bones you think you can do, but I think it's very valuable to give it a try in your next project. Another approach is actually using arrows in wireframes to prototype motion. So what I tend to do is use this Figma kit that's called FlowKit by the designer MDS. Normally, it's meant for connecting screens and more static kind of prototypes. But I've created a very simple system of using the components in this kit for motion. So this is how I use it. When I have solid lines, which are like this, this is supposed to be user-driven entry move or system-driven entry move. So when it's user-driven, there's this purple event happening. And when it's system-driven, there is no purple event. And when there's exits, I use dashed lines. And again, a purple hint for user-driven animation and not a purple hint for a system animation. So what is it good for? I think it's very good for defining initial motion directions when you want to just see where things will enter the screen or exit the screen without caring so much about easing or the actual polish, but just to see the choreography that you're trying to do. And also, I think if you already have a design system, this can be a pretty good approach because you can label your arrows with your design tokens. If you already have animations in production, you can actually name these arrows with the production animations, and you're one-to-one with the final app already, which is pretty cool. What it isn't good for, I think exploring totally new motion patterns, it's pretty hard to imagine them with just arrows. And prototyping complex flows with multiple steps can get messy since arrows overlap. So I think text-based is actually better for that. Another one that might be super obvious, and I don't know if you've tried it, but it's called, I call it motion simulation. So if you want to try a super simple animation, you can just screen record Figma or Sketch and move stuff with your mouse and then go back and forth with the sync bar of the video player. And this way, you can very easily see how the animation will look in a basic form. And if you want to try different speeds and different easings, you can actually do it with the sync bar on your video player. So I think it's a very, very low investment kind of way to share ideas. So let's see if we want this model to render from the bottom up or from the top down. We can just screen record, move it with the mouse, and replay it a few times to see the initial idea. A very quick rule of thumb for low fidelity prototyping. Let's say you're in a tool that doesn't support any complex motion. Let's say you're prototyping in Keynote or something that's totally that has a few options for easing and doesn't support custom properties. I think the rule of thumb is everything that enters the screen goes ease out, and everything that exits the screen goes ease in. So if you take this safe assumption and not go beyond it, your prototypes are going to look at least a little bit better in low fidelity if you don't just go with a linear animation in your low fidelity. So now I'm going to transition to more high fidelity prototypes, mostly around the web. Starting with web-based prototypes, I can show you a small sneak peek at the kind of component system we created to prototype in Webflow. So in many cases, we prototyped the product inside the actual product. So this is like a component system, very similar to a UI kit or a web-oriented design system. And we have these components with little motion artifacts attached to them. Like this one, for instance, you can just grab it and reuse it, and it carries its interactions with it. Or in this case, you can see how an element frame behaves on hover, and all of these elements you can build different UIs with and compose web prototypes with. So I think they're pretty sweet. And we also had another one for the editor in the light mode. Another cool demo, I think, is class-based motion. So when you're building for the web, I think it's very easy to attach some animation to a single class. Let's say you're working outside React and you're doing class-based stuff. So in this case, for instance, I wanted to prototype this model, so it doesn't really render and animate from the bottom up, but it kind of rotates like this, you see? There's this tilting motion. So to prototype this, I actually just attached this animation to a class and started adding and removing this class from the element. And you can also attach it to an aria attribute if you want it to be more accessible. So attaching a single animation to a class, I think, can be very, very powerful. Here's a few examples. When you're doing like a prototyping kit, you can create these reusable utility classes that do abstract animation. So let's say there's one that fades to zero, there's one that moves the element one rem up, there's one that moves it down one rem, there's upself, which moves it via its own height. So if it's 500 pixels, it moves 500 pixels up, like down self, left self, right self. All of these utility animations can be used both for prototyping and in production. And I have a few examples here how I've used them in this site we worked on. This is a template for a site we worked on that won Site of the Year later on. So for instance, in this case, when I click the search bar, you can see the menu bar animates down self and the search animates down self. And when I do it together, you get this effect of them switching. But it's just applying two classes to them. Same here on the cart. It goes left self and then it goes right self. So all these classes can be used very simply, like this one animates right self, and then animates left self. And all of these motions are done with the same classes, given that they are very abstract, and it's very fast to test with them. OK, carrying on. What is this good for and not good for? I think It's really good for prototyping complex choreographed animations with more polished timing, since you're in the real environment and you can actually see how it's going to behave in the real web. It's good for exploring new motion ideas. I think if you want to try something totally new and see it in isolation, you can very easily attach it to one class and care about one specific thing at a time, which makes it easier to test. And also relating how motion is going to work in production. I think if you're working for the web and prototyping on the web, you're actually in a very good scenario because you're almost 100% up to par with your engineers, and anything you're doing is kind of real and not something that can't be achieved later on. What it's not so good for, I think, like syncing multiple complex animations together. So if you have a lot of elements moving, you want to sync it just with manual timing, it can get very tedious. Like at some point you can't calculate delays all day, you have to start working with a more complex event system. And also relating to certain mental models today in React or Angular or Svelte, which are not class-based systems, it doesn't really relate this well to the most modern libraries, but I think it can still be adapted pretty well. The next example is even more complex motion. So this is an example of a engineering prototype I worked on, built in HTML, CSS, and a little bit of JavaScript. So with it, we managed to prototype like generative assets. So this one right here is a generative SVG asset, which can accept any other SVGs inside. And when you start voting, it actually transitions to a smiling face. And when you vote, actually, it transitions to an SVG of these people. So we've created this prototype system where engineers can actually feed any picture, any icon inside this frame, and it transforms it into this dot matrix with all the effects. Same thing with the little bubbles that are animating. All of these are generative. So I think for generative design, there's no way to really prototype in standard design tools. I think the only way to do it is by using either some super advanced new tools that I haven't heard of for coding by hand. Okay, so moving on. What are this type of more complex HTML, CSS, and JavaScript prototypes good for? I think for all the last ones weren't that good for, syncing multiple complex animations. If your events are driven by JavaScript and not just CSS, you can actually say, start this event when this event ends and not calculate 100 milliseconds and then 100 more. So it's much more easier to actually get the flow going. Also, as I showed, testing drag-based and interpolation-based motion in your choreography. If you want something to happen based on some user events and there's some math behind it, I think it's a very good way to test. Also, if you want to test with users, these prototypes can be on a real web link. You can send them out, you can collect feedback, you can do user testing sessions with them. And you can even use this animation in code. If you have the luck that your project is compatible with the approach you did during the prototyping phase, actually a bunch of the motion can make it to production, like in this case, with a little bit of optimization, of course. What it's not this good for, I think, is being quick to iterate. It's very, very involved, takes a lot of time, and also not super good for testing UX assumptions. I feel like these prototypes are 100% focused on doing complex motion and polishing your easing, polishing your visuals and everything, but I wouldn't use them for testing UX assumptions, to be honest. Small tip that I already mentioned, but I think it's pretty valuable. Always try to rewatch your interactions in slow motion. So you can just hit Command-Shift-5 on the Mac, record your stuff, and let's say in this case I wanted to prototype this little switch, but I really wanted to see how it's going to animate. So the scaling of the background starts a little bit earlier, as you can see, like this. And then the moment it turns into this line starts to animate, and the border also animates. And I really wanted to find the right timing for this so it feels right. It's actually much harder to do it in the browser or in your design tool and replay it. I think it's much, much easier to screen record it and then start playing back and forth. You can test different types of easings. You can speed it up. You can go back and forth much faster and share with teammates than the actual prototype. Another example, it's a Mapbox-based website where, you know, this map kind of pans around to the city of Malmö, and as you're moving the camera, at some point, the actual part, the landing part of the website appears on top of the city. So I really wanted to prototype where the actual tilt of the camera starts happening, when it starts rotating around the city, when it starts closing up, and where exactly this tooltip shows up. So again, using video recordings, it was much, much easier than rerunning the whole JavaScript engine multiple times and waiting.
So I think it's a simple but interesting tip to screen record your stuff and watch it back. So now I'm going to transition to engineering prototypes, I think the most involved kind of prototypes you can do. So here's an example of something I worked on, an engineering prototype done in React for team switching. So there it is. Let's say we have a dark mode and we want to swap teams on the whole app using this button, but not by doing it as one-off animations, but by actually transforming the token library at the low level. So we want to prototype how it's actually going to happen in the actual React app, not fake it with manual buttons and stuff. So by doing this, I think you can, by creating a small version of the app you're working on in an isolated environment, but using the same tools, so React in this case, you can get 100% close to your artifact. And you can actually inform your engineers on how this is supposed to work, even before they dive in. Another example here is using filter-based hovers, hovers and press states, so you can see how the buttons go darker when you click. But also in the light team, they also go darker using the same filters. There's no different effects on it. It's just a CSS filter called called brightness 90%, and it can be applied on all sorts of buttons and colors and environments. So this is another tip, trying to use procedural mutations on your components versus changing actual colors. I think it's more convenient. So moving here, like, what are the upsides here of this approach? I think you can gain kind of the highest possible confidence in an idea, because you're in the real app. You're doing the real environment. You're seeing the actual stuff. You can test with users at different scales. You can actually plug these prototypes into screen recording tools, into A/B testing tools. You can send it out to hundreds of people and collect quantified usage data. And you can also fine-tune your interactions. So they're good for a lot of stuff. Like, they're almost as good as testing with the actual product in production. But of course, what they're not this good at is being quick to iterate on and being cheap. And based on that, getting buy-in from your company. Like, these prototypes can take months of building to get going. So in most cases, I wouldn't say they're super convenient, and we should be mindful when we use them. And I'm going to end up with a section around design systems, which covers the topic. You know, we often think about motion in our design stage, but when we go to our engineers and start building in React, we get this notion that React doesn't animate and everything is removed or added to the DOM. So the vanilla React way is not to do animation. But I think with design systems, we can actually incorporate our motion in a pretty nice way. And here's a few examples of how I've done this previously in design systems related to motion. So treating transitions as tokens is the first example. Just having a token scale that's called transitions, in the simplest of ways, you can call them fast, medium, slow, and fancy, and have four transitions. And instead of using these values, you can just use the named values. You can go even fancier if you want. You can have general transitions, entry transitions, exit transitions, and just keep them as a token scale. The same way you have a token scale for colors, for typography, for sizes, and for everything, for opacities, you can have a token scale for transitions. Also, I think you can have a pretty cool scale about behaviors. I think it's it can be useful in almost every app. Here's an example of this, having a token scale called behaviors. And inside, you can have things like lighten, which applies a filter of brightness and raises it up. You can have something like darken that brings it down. And you can have even more complex things, like push down that animates the thing down when you press it, or highlight it, which adds background color and a border radius, so you have a visible selection behind the transparent element. So anything that is CSS can be tokenized in this way and used in a design system context. So I think it's actually not that much harder to have a token scale for animation than it is for anything else. And what about Figma? Like, all of us use Figma as a design tool. How do we integrate motion artifacts into Figma, which is a tool that inherently doesn't support motion in a big way? First plugin I want to mention that's not really related but pretty useful is called Figma Tokens. If you haven't tried it, it's extremely powerful and allows you to have tokens for almost anything inside Figma. So not just textiles or colors, but all sorts of properties. Sadly, one of them isn't motion, so this was a bit of a clickbait thing. But there's also the Figma Motion plugin, which allows you to do incredibly complex motion stuff inside Figma, export it as video or GIF. And actually, it's super involved and timeline-based, and I highly recommend this tool. It's not really token-based, but I think it's the best you can do when it comes to integrating motion with Figma. So yeah, basically, in Figma, you can't really work with motion. But I think as a design systems maintainer, you can do at least a little bit something, which is indicating your motion patterns inside your Figma documentation. So let's say you have the model component, and you know the actual tokens for its animations. You can reference them inside the documentation, so at least your teammates and your engineers know what to use in code. And yeah, back to the question, what is prototyping? Like, has your opinion about what prototyping is changed a little bit? Have you considered prototyping at a very early stage in the process where you can spend 20 minutes on it and not think about, let's say, a high-fidelity framer prototype? So in this way, I really think prototyping is a mental model. Like anything you want to prototype and you want to try to prototype, you shouldn't be afraid to prototype. I don't think we should wait for the final stages or try to fit in a narrow definition of what prototyping is. I think every design artifact in some way is a prototyping artifact. Because if we think about prototyping as a word, it means to create an early version of something that's not final. And this is what design is. Aren't we as designers creating prototypes for software that gets built after that? I think our whole work is prototyping. So I would leave you with that. Thank you.
Thank you, Darin. That was a great talk. It's great to have you. Wait, don't leave yet. Okay. There are questions.
Okay.
Not many of them, but still. All right. So for those who added those, for those who haven't added those questions, please use the Slido hashtag design. We have two of them, so let's deal with them right now.
Sure thing.
Darin, how much of coding should design system designer know?
Oh, that's the should designers code question, right? It's a very, very, very complex thing. I don't think there's a right or wrong answer. I think a design systems designer can be totally outside the world of code if they have the right support and a bigger team. I think if they're the only design systems designer in a smaller team, it might be beneficial, actually, to code. But let's pick an example that's outside the world of the web. Let's say you work something that's more rare, working for iOS. Like, should we expect all of our designers to know Xcode and Swift UI? Might be nice, but I think we should never expect designers to know how to code. I think it's a nice bonus. It makes some things easier, but this shouldn't become an expectation in the industry because it's hard. It's hard to be good at both, I think. It's almost impossible. Like, the more you invest into one of them, you lose a little bit of the other one and the other way around. So I think if you feel like learning to code and want to get better at it, you should never stop yourself. You should always try it. It's always great to learn new things. But don't feel like the industry demands this from you, because it's not true. Like, you can be an amazing design systems designer without touching code, I think.
Awesome. Thanks. What screen recording software would you recommend for Windows/macOS?
So, sorry for the Windows folks. Haven't touched Windows in more than 10 years. So I guess the built-in one in Windows is pretty good. For macOS, I use either the built-in one, just Command-Shift-5, or there's another one called CleanShot that I think it's really good. It's like an upgrade to the baked-in one. You can remap the normal commands to it, and it allows you to quickly edit your videos, create multiple videos, hide your desktop icons. But I think you would be good with even the baked-in one. It does everything you need, I think.
OK, cool. How about napkin prototypes? Are they useful?
So by napkin prototypes, you mean just paper sketches? Like whoever asked the question, do you mean?
Okay, yes, sort of in the paper sketches or when you cut them out, or just really drawn by hand on an iPad.
Okay, let me repeat that because
I think I heard actually.
Yeah, but
so everyone
people,
can. Yeah,
the people on the stream probably didn't. So the prototypes that are basically sketches on the paper or drawn by hand. Or iPad, sorry.
Yeah, I think there's a huge place for these types of prototypes. I actually use the iPad with a piece of software called Adobe Comp, which
the main thing it does, it makes your rectangles nice. So if you draw an ugly rectangle, it kind of magically makes it good, which is great because I can't really draw. For motion, I've actually tried this, what you said, cutting out paper pieces of, let's say, a few components and trying to animate them in real life with teammates. I think it works really nicely on a magnetic whiteboard. If you create these magnetic sticky notes and animate on it, it can be really fun. And of course, the goal there, I don't think it's to get high fidelity anything. I think it's to sync with your teammates in a fashion of play. I think encouraging play when prototyping motion with your teammates is the most important. Like not trying to be high fidelity at first, but trying to test as much things as possible in the simplest way. So paper-based is amazing. Yeah, haven't mentioned it here, but it's an incredible way to prototype, I think.
That's great insight. Let's do the last one. Do you see the early prototype with text the same as the storytelling, or does it have any difference?
Good question. Maybe not. Like I'm not a, I don't really stick to naming too much. I feel like if we describe the same notion together, it's the same thing, regardless of how we call it. I don't think naming is super important, but maybe the main difference between storytelling and text-based prototypes is if it's first person or third person. I think in text-based prototypes, I always try to go completely first person. So I'm describing the text as though I'm going through the whole thing, or as though I'm observing what's happening. While in storytelling, I think it's a bit more UX-driven. So they're very similar, maybe 90% similar, and also slightly different.
Okay, let's do the last one. Then we're going to have a break. Any motion prototyping tips for folks working on native mobile apps rather than web?
Yes, it's a great question, whoever asked it. Okay. also a good one, but let's not derail from now. Okay, so personally, in my free time, in my personal projects, I'm very interested in iOS and Xcode and Swift, so I can share some around that. I think the best prototyping tool for motion you can learn for iOS is actually SwiftUI, the one the engineers use to build stuff. So I think there isn't a better one currently. It's the easiest one and also the best one. Like, it's incredible how far Apple has come with making coding easy for designers. I think SwiftUI is the simplest abstraction you can start coding with as a designer. It's simpler than the web, it's simpler than React, it's simpler than anything you can do. And it has just one tip. In SwiftUI, you can do magic move, like in Keynote. So you can have one screen with a bunch of components, you move them to other places on the second screen, and you just go magic move, and it animates everything automatically. So prototyping for native, I think, is slowly becoming actually easier than for the web. And for the web, it's becoming a bit harder with switching to React, so it's interesting.
Awesome. Thank you, Darren. I know that there are other questions. Speakers will be here besides Ben, who's joining us remotely. So Darren's going to be here. Feel free to come to him, ask him those remaining questions. Thanks again.
Thank you.